you know there's something there.
Like father?
My father's side came from a family of witches and warlocks.
Like son?
I was committed to the dark side. I was committed to the demons. I was committed to the devil.
His deal with the devil.
The devil said to me, I give you anything you want. Just ask.
And his solemn vow.
I will worship the devil to the day I die.
What happens after we die? That's a question everybody wants to know. Do you go to some slow soul sleep? Are you extinguished? Or do you live on? And if you live on, where do you live? Is there a heaven? Is there a hell? And what are they like? Well, we're going to tell you about that today from eyewitness accounts. And today, as you know, is Halloween. Some kids will dress up as devils and go trick-or-treating. But for John Ramirez, the devil was more than a costume. He was John's father.
John Ramirez grew up in the Bronx, where his relatives practiced Santeria.
My father's side came from a family of witches and warlocks. My father was very heavy into Santeria, very heavy into spiritualism.
John longed for a relationship with his dad, but his father was abusive.
There was no love. There was no compassion. We watched him beat my mother in-house. He came in drunk most of the time, demanding stuff, asking for stuff. If things wasn't done a certain way, it was always put down. Hurtful words, dummy, stupid, you're going to amount to nothing, that kind of stuff. I would just stand by the door and look and see what he was up to because I was looking to see if there was time for me. Just to have an interaction, right? We did something, my dad and I did something. But he was connected to the demons. He was connected to spiritualism.
John's mother was also influenced by Santeria. At his aunt's suggestion, she took John to a tarot card reading.
The lady sent the cards. I had 30 days to do a ceremony or I would be blind. So my mother, as a good mother, didn't want nothing to happen to her son, so we did it. They blindfolded me, did a bath for me with herbs, and they started chanting and calling the five main god demons from Santeria.
From that moment, John's life changed.
My whole personality, everything who I stand for as a young boy, was no longer there. I felt like someone took a black blanket and just put it right over me, spiritually. I wasn't answering not only to my mom and my dad, but I was answering to the demons.
John's involvement with Santeria deepened quickly.
I was being taught and trained with high-ranked devil worshippers into spiritualism. I went to sinking into funerals, acting like I knew the person that died because I wanted to buy the soul, or that person that died because I can get that soul and put it on somebody and die the same way. When drug dealers got killed in the street, I wanted to run out and get the blood because I can use that human blood to do witchcraft.
For the first time in his life, John felt powerful and respected.
People knew that I was a force to be reckoned with. I like that power. I was talked down to as a young boy. Now I had the authority and the power that I can do whatever I want.
When John was 13, his father was murdered in a bar fight. John gave credit to the devil for relieving his mother's suffering.
I'd be up at 5 in the morning calling out to God saying, help my mother. And no one showed up. But the devil showed up because he killed my dad. I believe the devil said, well, no one loves you, but I love you. Your father can't provide for you, but I'm your provider. The devil said to me, do the religion. I give you anything you want. Just ask.
John says Satan became the father he never had. John was devoted to him.
I light up my candles. I spit the rum. I spit the cigar smoke. The cigar smoke means power. If I didn't have money for a rooster, I'd cut myself and use my own blood and pour it in. The whole atmosphere of the room changes. And you know there's something there. And then when it's there, you have to dress him like a family member. My father, I'm here. What would you like to speak to me about? What is it that you want me to do?
As time went on, John also practiced the dark arts outside his apartment. He preyed on Christians in particular.
At the clubs, I would go around looking for Christians. And I knew that in the club, you was in the devil's playground. So So I knew that if I can get into it and you had a beer or two already in your system, I knew all I had to do was just say, listen, I have something to tell you today. And right now you will open the door because you said, what is it you need to tell me? You gave me gateway.
Eventually, John became a high priest in Palo Mayombe, a form of African spiritualism. As he became more powerful, John took warfare seriously.
The devil told me that I had to go into the neighborhood in the spirit realm in order to weaken it in the natural. Whatever you kill in the spirit realm, you can kill in the natural. So I will leave my body home and astral project myself into different boroughs, different regions, different states, different countries. And as I fly to the neighborhood, I would speak curses into the neighborhood, speak things that I wanted to happen into the neighborhood. Sometimes I will go into neighborhoods and I see this group of people in the spirit realm in the corner praying, holding hands, heads bowed, praying up a storm. And there was no accomplishment in that neighborhood. That neighborhood was sanctified, blessed through prayer. There was, you couldn't touch it. But the other neighborhoods, it was party time.
Around that time, John met a girl who intrigued him.
I said, well, you know, I can hang out with her. She's good looking. And she invited me to church.
She also invited John to meet her parents, who talked to him about Jesus.
They had the Bible out. Hey, listen, we want to talk to you about this. I'm like, oh, I can't come to your house. Your parents are crazy. I said, at least let me digest the food, and then you can talk about this Jesus guy. And then after I leave her, I will go to worship. I will go to double church and kill animals all night long. And then I will come back and see her, but she didn't know.
John found the Christians amusing and harmless.
We had a different system that they had. Their stuff was just kisses, hallelujah, we love you. So I kept coming to church to please her, but I wasn't going to leave people I was committed to.
One Sunday morning, the pastor gave an altar call. John went forward, but wasn't prepared for what happened next.
I said, well, the devil can't touch me here. I'm in front of the pastor now. I'm protected.
All of a sudden,
I got demon possessed. I grabbed them by the throat, picked them up in there, and said, I came for you. And all these big men came out to see, try to grab me. I was just throwing people around like rag dolls. And then 200-something people got up and raised up hands. Spiritual warfare for a person that would have killed them on a heartbeat. I saw the power of God in the church. One of the guys was whispering back in my ear, say, Jesus is Lord, say, Jesus is Lord, say it. Jesus. I couldn't open my mouth. And then suddenly, I was able to say, Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord.
And the devil left.
John was embarrassed about the outburst, but not sure what to do next. One of the church elders approached him a few days later.
He said, Jesus wants you to have this. He gave me a sweatshirt. They said, you're a warrior, Christ. For someone to come and say, this is a gift in Christ, because he loves you. To me, that was amazing. I couldn't believe that Jesus loved me. But I was committed to the dark side. I was committed to the demons. I was committed to the devil. And I was betwixt two worlds.
One night, John decided to end the struggle between the two worlds the only way he knew how.
I said, boy, Jesus can't have me. The devil can't have me. The best way out is suicide. In my ignorance, in my shame, in my mind that was so far gone, spiritually drained, very spiritually drained.
John didn't know how to pray, but he began to talk to God.
I don't know what they call you, Jesus, whatever they call you in church. I don't like you. I never liked you. I never had nothing to do with you. I want no dealings with you. I hate you. I don't want to be part of you. I never want to be a Christian. I disown you. If that's going to get you away from me, I will worship the devil to the day I die. I whisper saying, if you are bigger than the God that I serve, then you show me tonight or leave me alone.
John went to sleep and dreamed he was on a subway.
The train was filled with people, and their faces were drained, and we were going somewhere that I know that was not good. And as the train was going faster than light, there was a lady dressed very elegant, and she started talking to me in demonic tongues. I understood the tongue. Traitor, you're leaving us. So I tried to get into the middle of the train, in the middle of the people, so she won't reach me. Pop hit. And the doors opened, I ended up in hell.
John stepped out of the subway and into the darkness.
As I went to the tunnels of hell, the heat. It wasn't the heat that you feel on Earth. It grips you, and the fear ropes around you. There's no hope. The hope is removed. As I got to a part of the tunnel, the devil came out, bigger and more strong. I've never seen him like that. And he said to me,
I've been with you since you were 9 years old. I've been a father to you. I've given you everything.
He said, I'm going to keep you here, because if I can keep you here, you won't wake up upstairs, which is on Earth. And he said,
you belong to me, and you're not going to leave. You know too many secrets about my religion.
And when he went to grab me, to snuff me, this 3-foot cross appeared in my hands. I couldn't understand how a cross would appear in my hand. I never called for the cross. I put it on the devil. And he felt like nothing. He felt like he was a baby. No powers at the foot of the cross.
When John woke up, he was a changed man.
And I knew that Jesus was the Lord. I bent my knee to the cross. And Jesus came into my life. I took a white piece of paper, and I wrote down a servant, a slave of Jesus Christ. I serve you all the days of my life.
John threw out all of his witchcraft paraphernalia, but the battle wasn't over. He was under spiritual attack every night for the next month.
At night, I felt a presence come into the room. And then when I would turn around, I would actually sometimes see what was there. Or sometimes I would just slip around and somehow fall asleep up this way, and I would just feel someone's hands just grab me by my throat and try to pick me off of the bed and try to rip my body. I rip my soul out of my body. Sometimes they grab by my feet and the bed would shake, and it would bring it up and levitate the bed and levitate me to the point that sometimes I might even reach the ceiling. And I couldn't breathe, and I couldn't cry out. I couldn't talk. I felt like I was choking. I felt like they were choking the life out of me. And I would try to call out for Jesus, and the words wouldn't come out. And then in the end, the word would come out, Jesus, help me. Jesus, help me. Save me. And it would go away.
John didn't understand why God permitted the nightly struggles.
I asked the Lord, why did you allow this to happen to me? Why this torment? Why did you allow these people to abuse me this way? I gave my life to you. I told you I would serve you. And he said to me, I wanted to know how much you love me, how much you trust me. And no devil ever showed up to my house ever again.
John says he wouldn't trade anything for what he's found in Christ.
For 25 years of my life, I was able to do anything to anybody. Anyway, I count that out to be foolish. To gain Christ. He's my all in all. He's the breath that I breathe. He walks with me. I can hear the sound of his voice in my ear.
Today, John shares the gospel with everyone he can. He has written a book about his experiences called Out of the Devil's Cauldron.
I've been victorious in Christ. I got peace. I'm not empty no more. I got fulfillment. I got a purpose, and I have a destiny today. And all because I say yes to the cross. And I am an evangelist for the kingdom of light. No more an evangelist for the dark side. I expose the dark side every time the Lord gives me a chance. Because you don't have to die in your sins. You don't have to shed blood like in Palamanyumbe. Jesus shed the blood for you. That's the blood that counts, the one at the cross.
You know, like it or not, the devil is real. It's not just a nameless force, evil. It is a person. It is a being. He was at one time an angel, a cherubim, the highest of God's creation. And then he fell, and he has nothing but hatred because he knows his days are short. His time to roam the earth is coming to an end. But right now, he wants to snatch as many people as he can and take them into hell. He wants to deceive them and blind them and take them away from the gospel. He will mock the gospel. He will mock God. He will blaspheme the Holy Spirit. He will blaspheme Jesus because he knows his days are short and he has great wrath. But you know something? The cross of Jesus Christ will defeat him. The cross of Jesus, the death and resurrection of Jesus. When Jesus hung on the cross and he said, "It is finished," he had taken all the abuse that the devil could heap on a human being, and he'd absorbed it, and he won. He won. Jesus is the victor. He won. He triumphed over Satan, and he did it for you. But which is it going to be? You have no choice to say, "Well, I don't want to really have anything to do with either one of them." You've got to choose. That Bob Dylan song, "You've got to serve somebody." You've got to serve somebody. Mm-hmm. You're either going to serve Jesus or you're going to serve the devil. There's no middle ground. There isn't kind of like a nice neutrality. It doesn't work that way because the whole world is divided into the forces of light and the forces of darkness, just like night and day. There is no middle ground between light and darkness. Now, I'm going to ask you today, do you want light? Do you want everlasting light? Do you want to be free? Don't submit. You say, "Well, I'm hooked on drugs." That comes from Satan. "I'm hooked on alcohol." Comes from Satan. "I'm hooked on pornography." Comes from Satan. "I'm hooked on stealing and evil." "I'm hooked on things that I'm ashamed of." Comes from Satan. Jesus Christ wants you to be free. And if you want that freedom, pray with me right now. These words, say it with me, Jesus. Say it, Jesus, I come to you now. I rebuke Satan and the forces of evil. And I renounce the dark side, and I turn to the light. Lord Jesus, I give my life to you, and I ask you to come into my heart, live your life in me, and I will live for you, and I will serve you all the days of my life. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen and amen. Now, if you prayed with me, I want you to rejoice in what God has done for you, and I want to give you something. You say, "What do I do next? I just don't want to leave you like an orphan." I want you to have something that'll help you. It's called A New Day. And in it, there's a little compact disc. You can put it in your CD player or borrow one if you don't have one. This thing is fairly short, 73 minutes, I believe it is, and it'll tell you what you've just done and what's to be done next. God has a great plan for you, a new day, and you've just been taken and moved from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. So rejoice. I want you to pick up your phone right now and call and say, "Look, I prayed with Pat. I gave my heart to the Lord. I will not participate in the works of Satan. I'm going to be free in Jesus Christ." Call now, 1-800-759-0700.